In September 1987, 15 European telecoms operators gathered in Denmark to sign a document that paved the way for global mobile. With all countries agreeing to services based on this common standard, a unified network was created across Europe for the first time. And as this standard, known as GSM, spread first to Asia and then America, it changed forever the way we communicate. Mobile has affected all of our lives, no matter where we live and what our social background. Francisco Torrega has now become composer of the most played piece of music in the world. 100 years after Grand Vals was first performed, it's hard to find anyone who doesn't, eventually, recognize the soundtrack to our mobile planet.
Before GSM, the world was analog, and it's interesting. Today I brought with me an analog phone. This was called, this euphemistically was the brick. And the brick at that time, for that period, was state of the art. So it was a wonderful product. But judged by today, it would be judged harshly. Too big, clunky, can't put it in your pocket. No roaming, no security. People could hear your conversations. GSM went digital, and it standardized. We transformed the phone from an impersonal item to a personal item. It became you. And not only was it you for that phone, it became you for whatever GSM phone you wished to use. We've gone from something that was very restrictive in one sense to something truly global, touching everyone's lives around the world.
Decades of war and civil unrest had virtually destroyed telecoms in Afghanistan. During Taliban rule, only 1 person in 100 had access to a telephone. There were no reliable landlines and no mobile networks.
When we entered the market in 2003, there were probably about 20,000 working phone lines across the country. The cost to make a call was as high as $2.50 a minute, and those calls could only be made from 4 cities in Afghanistan. People hadn't spoken for 23 to 30 years or hadn't been able to speak to their neighbors, to relatives in other parts of the country. So wherever you went, there was no fixed line network and there was huge demand, which made it commercially attractive for us to roll out that quickly.
Airtime is sold to mobile users by networks of hundreds of scratch card vendors.
They are the outbound sellers, a group of people that working for us for commission, and we give them a scratch card. They deliver to businesses or to shops, and they get cash in against their scratch card that they sell. In Kabul, we have about 25 to 30 outbound sellers. They have almost 100 to 150 people that they are selling to them, and then they sell it outside.
Roshan is one of the largest employers in Afghanistan, with over 900 staff, 20% of whom are women.
It was really hard at the beginning that to convince female to work. But now they see that Roshan has really a safe environment for them. We have good security, we have transportation system that to drop them home and pick them up in the morning. Now we see that it's increasing every day. If you walk around in our offices, you see female working in our call center, working in offices, and our goal is to increase and encourage more women to come and work.
Mobile phone technology isn't the answer to all the country's problems, but it's already made a significant positive difference in just a handful of years.
Of course, Afghanistan is a fractured society in the sense that you've had a history of refugee and migrant populations. And what it's allowing people to do is to communicate with each other within Afghanistan. And it's allowing them to communicate with their families and business partners outside of Afghanistan as well. So it's sort of bringing Afghanistan back to where it maybe was in terms of a hub, both economically and socially, you know, 40, 50 years ago.
Afghanistan is not alone in its desire to build out communications networks. A fast way to get services to villages and impoverished areas is through the use of community phones. In India, the Jagriti project reaches some of the country's poorest women. It proves how mobile can be a profitable business and empowers women to take a greater role in society.
से नंबर लेके पूछ ही जाओ भाई आप कहाँ से कर कहाँ करोगे अगर कोई पूरा नंबर लाए तो ठीक है नहीं मेरे पास कोड है मैं कोड खुद अपने घर से लगा के अपने आप और उनसे बात करवा दूँ बहुत लोगों को जानकारी है बहुत उनको हो गई है और बहुत ही आते हैं दिन में 4 भी 6 भी 10 भी कस्टमर आ जाते हैं पहले शहर में जाते थे अब यहाँ पर आ जाऊँ ऐसे कोई एक्स्ट्रा जरूरत रहे तो कोई कभी भी आ सके
50 kilometers away, another woman entrepreneur has set up her own phone business for an investment of about $75.
Alpana madam mili humko matlab yahan cycle foundation mein wahan hum madam ne bulaye matlab to main wahan pe nahi main duty de rahi hu gayi madam mere paas wahan se mere ko jankari li foundation te matlab jaisa foundation se jankari leke maine madam se baat karte madam ne se gayi ki is phone se matlab STD ka fayda ye fayda hai iste sasti bhi call hai किसी तरह रोजगार कमा भी सको
मोबाइल फोन की अहमियत यह है सर अगर जैसे देहात में वैसी एसटीडी तो कामयाब है नहीं क्यों नहीं तो एसटीडी कोई लाइन है और ना ही देहात में कोई एसटीडी चालू है तो मोबाइल की एक ऐसी वो है जी ना ही तो इसके लिए कोई लाइन बिछाने की जरूरत ना कोई और दूसरी जरूरत है तो सीधी अपने इस मोबाइल से यहाँ औरतें बेझिझक आती हैं गाँव की औरतें बेझिझक अपनी बात करती हैं ना ही तो उनको किसी आदमी से डर रहता ना कोई वो रहता कि मेरी बात को फलाना सुन लेगा या वो सुन लेगा ऐसी कोई उनके अंदर वो नहीं रहती थी
Each woman entrepreneur brings in about $8 per month. For many, this is the first time they have earned money.
और कोई रोजगार है अपने बच्चे को पार सकती है अपने पैसे हाथ में रहते हैं जी गांव में बहुत काफी ज्यादा फायदा हो रहा है जी
We do not go to African countries or Asian countries or Latin American countries and say, give us tax breaks, give us some kind of extraordinary benefits. We're asking them to allow us to build these networks, bring the prices down on these handsets, allow us to create with our colleagues in the vendor community as well as people who make a living on building applications to get on with our work. When you're putting on 1 million subscribers, every day, you're dramatically changing access for people. And as they have access, then they find out there are so many benefits they can get.
In Bangladesh, one of the poorest and most densely populated countries in the world, local operator Grameenphone is providing mobile internet access to villages.
There is demand, especially for mobile-based services, due to lack of infrastructure. So fixed-line penetration in Bangladesh is 0.2%, very low.
Already, there are over 600 community information centers across Bangladesh.
These centers are basically run as franchise shops. Grameenphone does not get involved in the day-to-day operation of the centers. They are owned and managed by an entrepreneur, either working directly with Grameenphone or through an NGO.
The center in Baluka has 2 PCs with internet connectivity via high-speed mobile modem. A facility like this can generate revenue of $200 per month, with about 12 people visiting every day. As well as downloading documents, villagers can use email and webcams to keep in touch with relatives abroad.
There is a demand for information-based services, and there is a demand for these centers. I wouldn't be surprised to see, say, 2,000 centers by end of 2008.
Community phones continue to be a hugely successful initiative in poor and underserviced areas. In South Africa, the mobile operators have established thousands of these local businesses.
In this country today, there is almost no one who does not have an access to a telephone, either their own phone or a community phone. And it's easy enough to put a GSM phone out in the middle of nowhere. It's a lot more difficult to make sure it's there the next day and still working and people taking interest in it's protected. And the only way that this thing could ever work was if the person that ran the shop was making money. And these are people who probably wouldn't have had a job. And now very successful business people running a telephone.
The Alexandra Township site was one of the world's first community centers to deploy high-speed HSPA technology.
Today we talk about HSPA, high-speed packet access, mobile broadband. Evolving now to speeds, we talk about speeds of 3.6 megabits per second. We talk about speeds potentially going up to 40 megabits per second and perhaps beyond. And suddenly we open up a whole new universe that had not been there before, which allows more applications and services that play to these higher speeds.
One of the first studies into the impact of mobiles on business in developing nations analyzed how they benefit the fishermen of India.
The mobile phone has helped fishermen to come out of the clutches of middlemen and get a fair value for their produce. Because once they get a catch, a good catch out in the sea, 6-7 miles out in the sea, the mobile phone is working there. Today it's completely accepted that it is required for everyone for day-to-day life and activities. It is seen as a necessity for the housewife, for the vendor, the priest. It has touched all segments of life.
You don't have to venture far into the streets of New Delhi to see what he means.
ऐसा था सर कि जैसे घर घर जाके पूछना पड़ता था चाहे वो किसी के थ्रू आपके मैसेज भेजते हैं जब पहुंचते अब तो घर बैठे ही काम आ जाता है शनिवार है इतवार है दो दिन छुट्टी होती है छुट्टी के रोज आदमी बुला ही लेता है पड़ा है पहले 10,000 5,000 का महीने कमाते हैं हम 10-20-25,000 कमाते हैं
In markets all around the world, mobiles are now playing a significant part in trading. Godfrey Fuwamba works for the Kenyan Agricultural Commodity Exchange. Every morning, he goes to the Nairobi market to collect prices from the local traders. He records them in his notebook, then sends them back to his office via SMS, where they are compiled into a daily national database.
It's a tool for conducting business, a most efficient tool, one might add, now used to communicate, to conduct the farming business. You know, if you want to know where you're going to sell your maize and where the best prices are, you check on the mobile phone, and the mobile will tell you that maize prices in Kitale, for example, are so much money. Maize prices in Nairobi are so much money. It is a tool. It is not just a phone. It's a tool for conducting business, a most efficient tool, one might add.
Now, when somebody wants to know the prices, what he does, he has called the messages, create a new message. Then key in the name of the commodity that he wants to know the price, then send to 411. Then once he's sent to 411, he waits and gets the reply. Once he gets the reply, he'll be able to know that the price in Nairobi was this much, the price in Mombasa was this much, the price in Kitale, the price in Entebbe was this much. So he can be able to make a decision. People don't have to waste time to travel from one market to another to find out how it is. He has got the information that just on the phone, just the price of a pattern. Then be able to make a decision whether do I travel or should I just send where I am.
Mobile is also helping disabled people get a start in business. Kenyan operator Safaricom has come up with a truly mobile public phone.
We launched a project whereby we actually took some tricycles which disabled people use, and in association with the Kenya Association of Physically Disabled, designed a tricycle, which has the Simu Yajumi phone built into it, so that it enables people who are physically disabled, who can get around in either a wheelchair or in a tricycle, to actually become part of the community again by starting up their own business. So there's a dual purpose to this. One is to make these people feel part of the community, but also to give them the ability to actually run their own business and earn money.
For all businesses to work, there needs to be a reliable payment system. But in developing countries, 9 out of 10 people have either no access or limited access to a bank account. Mobile-based microfinance systems could provide the solution.
It is not a banking system, but it is a money transfer system. There is a tremendous benefit for the people of Kenya because a lot of money is transferred around the country.
The bulk of the centers are really in the big cities. So we have agents in the big city like where we are now in Nairobi. Then we also have agents in the rural markets, which are mainly cash out centers. Because it is in most of the big cities where people have flocked into for employment, and they have the money to send to the rural areas where their parents are or their wives are in the rural markets. So they do most of the sending.
Very simple equipment is needed to set up a new agent.
So it's a SIM card, it is a handset, and most importantly, this might not look like an equipment, but it's the personnel to be able to do the transactions in the outlet. Then on top of that, we require them to have other tools like the logbook, which basically is for the customer to sign that they have received the money that they deposited or that was sent to them. So we currently have customers that do not have the M-Pesa enabled SIM card, and we have to do a SIM replacement.
Another pioneering microfinance scheme was started by Globe Telecom in the Philippines.
A large segment of our population is unbanked. They have no access to banking facilities, and when they do, it comes at a very high price. The 8 million Filipino overseas workers sometimes depend on a remittance channel which charged them an arm and a leg to make a remittance. So we said, well, the mobile phone is so pervasive in the Philippines. Practically everyone who can use it has it. And people who have relatives abroad or relatives in the provinces or far away from themselves who send and receive money, why can't they do that via the mobile phone?